Another Hong Kong media organization shuts down.
And South Korea records its first two fatalities due to the Omicron COVID variant.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, the Philippines once more at high risk for COVID-19 amid a rapid rise in infections. It has yet to be confirmed whether the increase is due to the Omicron variant, but a top pandemic response official expects the strain to become the dominant COVID variant within a month. Rafael Buzano has tonight's top story.
Last December 27, the health department reported that the entire country and all its regions are classified as minimal risk in terms of COVID-19 cases. But after seeing a daily increase in infections, just a week after, the DOH reports that the country is now once again classified as high risk in terms of the number of cases. While a lot of regions remain minimal risk, Region 4A has escalated to moderate risk, while Regions 3, 9, 11, and 10 have become low from minimal. All regions are showing signs of increase, but it is the National Capital Region that's observing a rapid increase. From December 20 to 26, the country had an average daily cases of 307. But in the 7 days that followed, average cases have reached 2,057, an increase by 570%. For Okta fellow Dr. Guido David, the possibility of cases continuing to rise is high, especially in the NCR.
Unfortunately, mukhang madadagdagan pa itong bilang ng kaso. Sa atin, most likely baka malagpasan natin yung mga yung numero na nakita natin ng Delta surge sa NCR na mga 9,000 cases. So, most likely baka hihigitan pa natin itong 9 or even 10,000 cases per day.
The positivity rate in all regions has also seen an increase. But the DOH explains that all regions except for the NCR have seen a dip in the number of samples subjected to testing. It still cannot be confirmed whether or not the more transmissible Omicron variant is fueling the rise in infections. But the DOH assumes the variant is now in the communities.
Based on observations sa ngayon, ang assumption natin na andyan na siya sa community because we have seen the sudden increase in the number of cases. Now for us to declare or to be able to determine if there is local transmission, kailangan pa rin po natin ng definitive, no, or confirmatory test from the whole genome sequencing or the Philippine Genome Center so that we'll be able to really say na talagang Omicron yung mga kaso.
Which we presume.
Treatment Chief Leopoldo Vega meanwhile sees Omicron as becoming the dominant variant in the country within a month.
The Omicron will be dominant in terms of 50% to 90% of the cases overtaking the Delta virus. But the Delta virus definitely is still around with us. It exists toe in toe with the Omicron virus right now.
The question now is, when will cases peak and by how many? Professor Joma Gabahante of the UP Pandemic Response Team says it may happen soon.
Pinaka-early neto ay January 15. Yung half ng middle ng January, yung pinaka-late naman ay third week ng February. So nandiyan yung posibleng peak na mangyari. And yung size ng peak natin, kung gaano kalaki, yung reported cases natin ay posibleng mag-range from 20,000 to 40,000.
The Philippines recorded 4,084 new COVID-19 cases Monday. 21 labs were not able to submit data. The 20.7% positivity rate reported today is the highest since September 30th. The health department also recorded 16 additional deaths, as well as 497 new recoveries. Health experts urged those who are still unvaccinated to get their jabs, since there are other diseases present.
Our very first COVID death in the Philippines back in January 2020, a Chinese national, had both influenza B and coronavirus. And he also had streptococcus pneumonia. But it's not unusual to see co-infection in these cases. And that is why we advise everyone, especially those who are vulnerable, to get your influenza shot.
Rafael Buzano. ABS-CBN News.
Metro Manila's hospitals and quarantine facilities prepare for a surge in COVID admissions. Sandro Chona tells us at least one hospital has temporarily stopped accepting non-COVID patients.
The emergency room at Dagat Andres Bonifacio Hospital in Tondo, Manila remains closed for a thorough cleaning after a sudden rise in COVID cases among patients and healthcare workers. More than 50 health workers and 30 patients all tested positive.
Gusto naming gawin na maglinis muna kami. Naglilinis po kami ngayon ng aming mga areas at saka nag-mask swabbing po kami, nag-mask testing para ma-isolate na po namin totally. So far naman po after 3 days of mask testing, na-isolate na namin lahat at naka-quarantine na po itong mga empleyado namin.
The Tondo Medical Center also recorded a rise in cases. Almost 60 were admitted there and another 32 in their extension hospital at the PICC. Most of them are mild to moderate cases.
Before Christmas, ilan lang ang patients namin eh. Halos hindi nga napupuno yung wards. Pero ngayon, medyo tumaas, no? More than fourfold yung pagtaas ng patients.
Justice Jose Abad Santos General Hospital has also stopped receiving new patients because of the surge. Medical staff assigned to their triage, emergency room, and COVID wards were not spared. In Dr. Jose N. Rodriguez Memorial Hospital and Sanitarium or Tala Hospital in Caloocan, cases rose from 25 last Christmas to 104 on Monday. 26 health workers also tested positive.
Yung natitira pa po dito para ho hindi mahawa ng COVID-19 infection. Bali, may agreement na po kami ng other Metro Manila tertiary hospitals na doon namin sila ililipat para pure COVID hospital na uli kami.
UPPGH is converting back their COVID wards, which has been used for non-COVID patients. 116 are currently admitted from 30 patients during Christmas. At least 10 to 15 patients were admitted there in the last 3 days alone.
Kailangan naming unti-unti ikakalibrate po namin ang need. Dahil hindi mo rin basta-basta pwedeng paalisin yung mga non-COVID na naka-admit doon.
In Manila, its mayor has instructed to reopen all their 12 quarantine facilities with about 500 bed capacities which could cater to mild cases. In Marikina, a third quarantine facility was opened after two of its facilities became full during the weekend. The DOH says those who are admitted are usually unvaccinated. But authorities say hospital utilization remains low.
The hospital utilization rate, nasa low risk position pa tayo. In other words, there is still about less than 30% being occupied by the COVID-19 patients. If we have an exponential growth in this Omicron, we might have problems in terms of isolation or quarantining this COVID positive patients.
The DOH will focus on preparing the 115 temporary treatment and monitoring facilities in the country in anticipation of another surge. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
Metro Manila returned on Monday to a higher COVID-19 alert level amid concerns over the fast-spreading Omicron variant. My colleague Pia Gutierrez tells us what this means for businesses and residents in the capital region.
Metro Manila returned to Alert Level 3 on Monday over fears of a possible local transmission of the highly contagious Omicron variant, as well as the continuing increase in COVID-19 cases. Under Alert Level 3, face-to-face classes for basic education will not be allowed, as well as contact sports and kid amusement industries. Also prohibited are venues with live voice or wind instrument performers and audiences, such as karaoke bars, concert halls, and theaters, among others. Gatherings in residences with individuals not belonging to the same households are also not allowed.
We've been through this before, no? Okay. Ang kaibahan lang is we came from a high alert level and then we went down from alert level 4 to 3, di ba? Before we went to 2. We again have to relearn. Huwag po tayong pumayag na may pumasok sa mga residences na hindi taga roon.
Interzonal and intrazonal travel will still be allowed under Alert Level 3.
However, minors 17 years old and below, as well as those belonging to the vulnerable population, such as individuals with comorbidities and senior citizens, will be required to stay at home, unless for work in permitted industries, and to obtain essential goods and services. Nograles says the COVID-19 Interagency Task Force will revisit these rules when it meets Tuesday, taking into account the progress in the country's vaccination drive.
During that time, hindi pa natin nababakunahan yung below 18. But right now, things are different. Right now, we are allowing now that we are giving vaccination now to 12 to 18, remember. And then marami na sa mga senior citizens natin ang bakunado na.
Still under Alert Level 3, the following establishments and activities will be allowed to operate at a maximum of 30% indoor venue capacity for fully vaccinated individuals only and 50% outdoor venue capacity. Venues for MICE or meetings, incentives, conferences, and exhibitions. Social events, tourist attractions, amusement parks, religious gatherings, dine-in services, personal care services, fitness studios, non-contact sports, and film, music, and TV production. Meanwhile, MMDA Chairman Benhur Abalos says Metro Manila mayors have agreed to pass local ordinances that will bar unvaccinated people from making non-essential trips.
Para kang nag-ECQ only for the unvaccinated, no? For their own protection. Dapat nasa bahay lang sila, pwede silang lumabas kung bibili na sila ng essential goods and services.
Abalos says this policy will be in effect while Metro Manila is under the stricter Alert Level 3. He adds, mayors are still finalizing the restrictions.
The Philippine Interior Department orders random inspections of quarantine hotels in the wake of breaches of health protocols. The police have been tapped to help monitor at least 150 accredited hotels that serve as quarantine facilities for incoming travelers.
Kung wala po yung tao doon, ay kaagad-agad pong iimbestigahan at sasampahan po ng kaso yung hotel at yung individual na skip quarantine at lahat po ng mga tao na may kinalaman sa ganung modus operandi.
The stricter monitoring comes amid backlash from the case of a Filipina who arrived from the United States and slipped out of quarantine to attend a party. The woman, Gwyneth Chua, later tested COVID positive along with seven of her close contacts. The tourism department on Monday revealed another Filipino was caught skipping quarantine. The person was caught after going out for a massage and posting photos of it on social media. Violators of COVID-19 health protocols in the Philippines face a fine of up to 50,000 pesos or imprisonment of up to 6 months. Malacanang vows to take tougher actions on violators.
Because of what happened, number one, we will ensure that whatever applicable laws that can be enforced, we will enforce. Whatever can be prosecuted and who can be prosecuted, we will prosecute. No, and it's not just, you know, civil cases to be filed, but talagang criminal charges will be filed against those responsible, whether it's the violator or the establishment. We will do what is necessary to serve as an example also to all.
Businesses in Metro Manila are expected to take another hit from tighter pandemic restrictions. The Philippine Trade Chief admits the shift to Alert Level 3 could affect up to 200,000 jobs. This report from Warren De Guzman.
Personal services, including barbershops, have once again been forced to limit their customers after the National Capital Region was returned to Alert Level 3. Barber Santos is more than disappointed. He is afraid this latest tightening might force his employer to close permanently.
Hindi na rin ako sang-ayon sa ganyan Alert Level 3 na yan kasi lalong-lalo na vaccinated na tayong nakabakuna na tayo eh, pero bakit kailangan pang ibalik yan mga yan? Sabi dati, pag nakabakuna ka na, pwede ka nang gumala.
After having experienced a bit more freedom during the fourth quarter of 2021, many loathed the return to a tighter alert level. The Federation of Filipino-Chinese Chambers of Commerce and Industry Incorporated fears small and medium businesses enticed to reopen because of the momentum experienced in the fourth quarter may be the first victims of this latest tightening, especially if they don't have enough capital. But the FFCCCII believes the government won't allow more businesses to close, having changed its COVID playbook. It also believes the Omicron variant is less deadly and therefore less troublesome.
A good thing is that they're not making it indefinite. They're now doing it in 2-week segments, which means that they're taking a very calibrated approach, a very logical approach.
But the Employers Confederation of the Philippines still expects businesses to take a hit, especially those forced to take in less customers, such as restaurants and malls.
Marami na naman yung magugutom, marami na naman yung mawawala ng trabaho. Una-una, yung mga non-essentials na mga ano, mga nagtatrabaho pa sa nasa probinsya yan eh. Pinatawag na yan, pumapasok na yan mga yan. Uuwi na naman. Anong gagawin dito sa Manila? Wala namang ayuda yan mga yan.
Trade Secretary Ramon Lopez says the higher alert level could cause as much as 200,000 workers to lose their jobs. But he notes the differences between alert level 2 and 3 are quite small and many businesses will still be able to generate some income.
Itong maganda sa alert level system natin ngayon, it allows all businesses to continue to operate, no? Maliban lang doon sa yung hindi na in-exclude natin. Ang pinaka-importante dito ay yung mailayo na natin yung ating bansa sa posibleng biglang pagdami ng Omicron cases.
Labor Secretary Sylvester Bello adds the government is prepared to provide affected workers financial aid, including an emergency employment or cash for work program for up to 40,000 informal workers and the COVID-19 adjustment measures program, which will give formal workers a one-time cash assistance worth 5,000 pesos.
Ang magbibigay ng pangalan ay yung mga employers. Ibibigay sa amin yung pangalan nila. And after they give us the name of their employees who will be temporarily displaced, ibibigay namin yung sweldo nila o yung cash assistance sa kanilang employer at ang employer ang magbibigay doon sa kanyang empleyado. Kung gusto naman nila, we can send it immediately.
Bello says over 100 employers have already applied for assistance through CAMP, but he expects that number to grow. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
Metro Manila residents rushed to get vaccinated against COVID-19 amid rising infections in the region. Data show majority of patients now in intensive care units are unvaccinated. Vivian Gulia reports.
Residents filled this COVID vaccination site in Manila once more as the National Capital Region saw a spike in COVID infections. Many of them are seeking to get a booster shot or additional COVID vaccine dose. In Marikina City, the 4,500 daily slots for booster shot are fully booked until January 14th. To accommodate more residents, the local government plans to open additional jabbing sites.
Simula bukas ay magdadagdag tayo ng 3 pang vaccination site. May target output na 10,000.
The Department of Health says around 85% of COVID patients in Metro Manila's intensive care units are unvaccinated based on the December 28 data from some of the region's hospitals. The DOH and the vaccine expert panel again call on those eligible for a primary COVID vaccine dose or a booster shot to get inoculated.
Kapag bakuna kayo ng at least isa man lang, meron kayong protection hanggang mga 52% against hospitalization. Hindi natin sinasabi against infection kasi napaka-bilis ng transmission sa ating Omicron.
Over 1.8 million individuals received a booster shot in the Philippines, while around 49.8 million have been fully vaccinated. That's short of the country's target to complete the COVID vaccine of 54 million Filipinos, or close to half of the Philippine population by the end of 2021. Presidential Advisor for COVID-19 Response, Secretary Vince Dizon explains the devastation from Typhoon Odette slowed down the COVID vaccination in parts of the country. But he is optimistic the 2021 target can be achieved within the first week of January. The country is now eyeing to fully vaccinate 70 million Filipinos within the first quarter of 2022. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The chief of the Philippine Food and Drug Administration abruptly resigns. Eric Domingo exits from the agency, which oversaw the approval of COVID-19 vaccines for emergency use in the country. His stint was not without controversies, among them the illegal COVID vaccination of the Presidential Security Group. The FDA under Domingo also gave a special permit to select hospitals for use of the anti-parasitic drug ivermectin as a COVID treatment. Domingo told ANCX last year that dealing with clashing opinions from different sectors was among the most challenging aspects of his job. Still to come, a U.S. congressional panel probing the January 6 Capitol riot considers summoning its Republican colleagues.
More stories when the World Tonight returns after the break.
We're back on The World Tonight. A third pro-democracy media outlet in Hong Kong is shutting down. The independent online publication Citizen News will cease operations Tuesday. It attributes the move to what it describes as Hong Kong's deteriorating media environment. This comes a month after Hong Kong authorities raided the office of the pro-democracy news site Stand News. A national security investigation last June also led to the closure of the Apple Daily tabloid. Its chief executive, Jimmy Lai, was arrested and jailed.
The U.S. House Committee investigating the deadly January 6 attack on the U.S. Capitol is weighing whether to subpoena Republican members of Congress. Here's the full story.
A U.S. congressional probe of the deadly January 6 Capitol riot a year ago is now looking into issuing subpoenas to sitting Republican lawmakers. Democratic Representative Benny Thompson, who chairs the special committee, on Sunday told NBC News that his panel was examining whether it could lawfully subpoena current members of Congress. Quote, "I think there are some questions of whether we have the authority to do it," Thompson said, according to an interview transcript. "We're looking at it. If the authorities are there, there'll be no reluctance on our part." The panel is investigating the day thousands of supporters of former President Donald Trump, egged on by false claims of election fraud, attacked police, vandalized the Capitol, and sent lawmakers and then-Vice President Mike Pence running for their lives. The committee also wants to know what happened inside the White House and is seeking communications between Trump allies in Congress and the former president's staff. Multiple people close to Trump, including conservative media TV hosts, urged him during the riot to make a televised speech telling his supporters to stop the attack. Trump waited hours before releasing a pre-recorded message. The special committee last month sent a letter to Representative Jim Jordan, a Republican and ardent Trump ally, asking for testimony about his telephone conversations with Trump on the day of the riot. Jordan said in a recent Fox News interview that he had, quote, real concerns about the committee's credibility, but was reviewing its letter to him. The committee sent a similar letter to Republican Representative Scott Perry. Perry declined to cooperate, posting on Twitter that the committee, quote, is illegitimate and not duly constituted. An appeals court ruled earlier in 2021 that the committee was legitimate and entitled to see White House records Trump had tried to shield from public view.
The Omicron COVID variant reportedly claims two lives in South Korea, while India starts to give COVID jabs to children 15 to 18 years old. The international COVID updates in this report.
South Korea reports its first deaths linked to the Omicron variant. The Yonhap news agency said two people who posthumously tested positive for Omicron appear to be the first deaths due to the strain in the country. But officials are still investigating the exact cause of death of the two patients, who were both in their 90s. The U.S. broke the single-day case count of COVID cases several times in the last week. The weekly increase in cases also registered a new pandemic high, with over 2 million new infections added to the tally. Based on the latest count by Johns Hopkins University, the U.S. has now breached 55 million cases and 826,000 deaths. America's top infectious disease expert says there is still a danger of a surge in hospitalizations.
You've got to be careful about that, because even if you have a less of a percentage of severity, when you have multi-fold more people getting infected, the net amount is you're still going to get a lot of people that are going to be needing hospitalization.
France becomes the sixth country in the world to report more than 10 million COVID infections since the start of the pandemic. France joins the United States, India, Brazil, Britain, and Russia in breaching the 10 million mark. French health authorities confirmed more than 200,000 daily COVID cases for a fourth straight day. Some big cities, including the capital Paris, have reimposed the wearing of face masks outdoors. India started vaccinating children 15 to 18 years old against the coronavirus on Monday using Bharat Biotech's Covaxin vaccine. Also on Monday, Indian authorities reported more than 33,000 new COVID-19 cases and 123 deaths. 1,700 were Omicron cases. The UN Children's Agency UNICEF estimates India has the largest population of adolescents in the world, with about 253 million.
Philippine shares start the new trading year deeply in the red following the reimposition of tighter curbs against COVID-19 in the capital region. Michelle Ong reports.
Philippine shares were sold off on the first trading day of the year as the spike in COVID-19 cases gripped investors and the capital and nearby areas were placed under stricter quarantine restrictions. For the day, the PSE index fell 81 points to close at 7041, with decliners beating advancers 141 to 66. COL Financial's April Lee Tan says the surge isn't a big surprise to investors. Worst case, we could see another flat finish this year. But there's actually more upside now to the market, with companies better prepared with their playbook.
I don't think there was much of an animal spirit anyway, if you think about it, notwithstanding the fact that we loosened our restriction in the fourth quarter. The market, you know, I mean, hardly moved. It was just there. So I wouldn't say that, you know, we enjoyed much of that positive sentiment in 2021, because I think that a lot of investors are, you know, even before we had this latest surge, I mean, everybody you talk to who goes out and who sees what's going on are saying we're going to have a surge this 2022.
In corporate stories, Philippine Airlines emerges from U.S. Chapter 11 bankruptcy process 4 months after its voluntary filing. This essentially wipes out over $2 billion in debt and gives it additional liquidity, including a $505 million investment in long-term equity from PAL's majority shareholder, Lu Shutan. Under the recovery plan, PAL can also obtain up to $150 million in additional financing from new investors. The flag carrier is ready to restore more routes and flights, build more code-sharing partnerships, expand its cargo business, and accelerate its digitization. PAL Holdings shares closed at 6 pesos when it traded last on June 2021. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Mahatma Gandhi. If we are to make progress, we must not repeat history, but make new history.
And that is the world tonight, the 3rd of January, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Happy New Year. Mabuhay!